Well, folks, I am so thrilled to get to be sharing with you again this morning. Although I don't know what's going on, I don't know if I have a cold or allergies or what, but I sound a little scratchy this morning, so you got to forgive me. But for those of you that it might be your first time here, again, we're so glad to have you. But I'm going to warn you up front, okay? This morning, it's not quite like a normal Sunday service. And this is going to seem not quite like a normal Sunday sermon like you might expect, because we are in the midst of what we call our summer teaching series, and we've been talking about this idea of roadblocks. We've been examining the obstacles and the hang-ups that keep people from faith in Jesus Christ. And so this morning, I'm going to try to tackle a big one. For some people, it's the biggest one, and this roadblock often goes something like this. People say, well, I'm not a Christian because the Bible, it is just so full of errors. They say, oh, the Bible, it's just a jumbled mess of contradictions. It's so old. It's been copied so many times. The real facts, the real story, it's long gone. Oh, the Bible is just a myth or a fairy tale. Jesus, he wasn't like a real historical figure. He's more like a legend, like King Arthur or Robin Hood or something. I don't trust the Bible. Now, I bet for many of you here this morning, you've got a friend or a family member that they kind of hold on to this perspective. Or maybe you're here with us this morning, or maybe you're watching on the live stream today, and this kind of summarizes your view on the whole Christian thing. And if that's you, I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad that you're willing to come and listen. We built this place so that people could come and wrestle with the issues of faith, even if they wouldn't claim to be a believer. So if you were here a few weeks ago, I was kind of talking about my love for mystery stories. And so this mystery about can we trust the Bible, to get to the bottom of this, we're going to put on our metaphorical detective hats, and we're going to use our logic and our reason, and we're going to dig into the evidence for the historicity of Jesus Christ. So, you know, there's no statute of limitations on homicide. So unsolved cases go into what's called a cold case file. And occasionally, cold case detectives, it's not just a TV show, it's a real thing. There are these specialized law enforcement professionals who will re-examine a previously retired file, hoping to shed some light on the truth and solve murders. Some of them took place 20 years ago or longer. And so one such cold case detective is a man named Jim Warner Wallace. Now, Wallace, you maybe have recognized him before because he's been featured many times on NBC's Dateline, and his investigations have been critical in solving multiple homicide cases from decades ago. Jim was a second-generation cop. He started out as a patrol officer, but he was quickly promoted to detective in his 30s. Jim was always a loving family man, but when it came to spiritual stuff, he was an avid atheist. Jim would say he was a man of reason and science, a man who demanded proof. And as an intellectual, he mocked Christians for clinging to their silly myths. But then one day, a friend invited Jim and his wife, Susie, to his church. And so almost as a favor to this friend, he went. And he went in and he was so prepared to cross his arms and dig in his heels. He wasn't going to be motivated by any of this stuff. And yet when he experienced that Sunday morning church experience, he was so touched. And the experience was so wonderful and the message was so compelling that he decided he was going to look into this Christianity stuff for himself. But understand, Detective Jim, he was not about to take any of this stuff by faith. He was going to use all of his skills as a detective to examine the evidence and see if this Bible stuff was really reliable. And so, friends, like Jim this morning, we're going to begin collecting the evidence. We're going to begin examining the reasons and all the clues in this great case for the historical Jesus. And so if you're following along, I'm going to warn you right now, get your pens ready. There's going to be a lot of numbers and figures and stuff to take down, so buckle up. Here we go. The first thing I want to examine this morning, if you're taking notes, is this. We're going to talk about the accuracy of the New Testament accounts. The accuracy of the New Testament accounts. Now, when we read any document of antiquity, you got to ask the question, how do we know that what we're reading is an accurate reproduction of the original author? I mean, it was written hundreds of years ago. How do we know that it wasn't tweaked or changed or downright manipulated? Well, there are these people called epigraphists, those who study ancient manuscripts, and they have a gamut of scientific tests used to verify the authenticity of any historical document. And so the first test you might use is this one right here. It's called the author proximity test. Now, when it comes to this test, the most important thing you're looking for is two different types of proximity. First of all, physical proximity, how physically near was the author to the events he or she recorded. And second, temporal proximity, how chronologically close was the author to the alleged event. Now, as far as author proximity, the Gospels of Matthew and John were written by the disciples of Jesus himself who were eyewitnesses to the actual events. The Apostle John says this. He says, "We saw him with our own eyes, and we touched him with our own hands. He is Jesus Christ, the Word of life." Historians tell us that the Gospel of Mark is the story of Jesus' life as remembered by Peter and written down by Mark. Luke was a Greek physician who came later to the faith, but he used all of his scholarly precision and academic rigor to make sure he got the facts straight. Look at how he puts together his biography of Jesus. He says this, "Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were what? Eyewitnesses and servants of the word. Therefore, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, it seemed good also to me to write an orderly account." Now, the four gospel stories, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which are biographies of Jesus' life, they were written by those who were either physically present at the events or those who interviewed those who were at the events. Guys, you cannot get any closer when it comes to author proximity. Contemporary scholarship agrees that most of the New Testament was written and finished between 20 and 30 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. Now, if you first hear that number and you think, well, 20 years later, that might seem like a long gap of time to you, but friends, it is amazingly close in the world of ancient manuscripts. So let me give you an example. Let me pick on the Buddha for a moment. Okay, the Buddha is actually a guy named Prince Siddhartha. He lived in India, and he died around 480 BC, but no one took the time to write down his life story until somewhere around AD 200, which is 700 years after he was dead. How could you know they got the story right? Or let me ask you, how many of you know, have you ever heard the story of Julius Caesar's life? You heard of that guy before? Yeah? How do you know the story of Caesar? Probably in high school, like me, you were forced to read William Shakespeare's version of Caesar, right? And so that's where you got it. But you know, Et tu, Brute? You guys remember that? Shakespeare based his story of Caesar on the writings of Plutarch, who didn't record the events of Caesar's life until over 150 years after Caesar's death. Friends, if you start examining it, 20 years seems amazingly close when it comes to history. Then the next epigraphy test is what's called the manuscript test, okay? And in this test, the most important text part of it is manuscript volume, okay? So before the printing press, all documents were painstakingly copied by hand, which means over hundreds of years of transcription, scribal errors may have occurred. However, the more documentation you have, the more manuscripts, the easier it is to decipher the original text. And so when it comes to summarize, when it comes to manuscript evidence, more is better, okay? So again, to give you some examples here, I've got a list. Plutarch's Lives of the Nobles. Go ahead, here we go. Plutarch's Lives of the Nobles, where Shakespeare got his biography of Julius Caesar, it exists in only 6 copies ever discovered on planet Earth. We found only 8 documents of the Roman historian Herodotus. Even the entire works of Aristotle are established by only 49 ancient copies. Now, the silver medal in manuscript attestation goes to Homer's Iliad, with a whopping 643 scrolls discovered. It blows most ancient documents way out of the water. Which then makes me wonder, are you curious? How's the New Testament doing when it comes to manuscript attestation? How does it match up? Friends, as of today, there have been over 5,500 ancient Greek manuscripts discovered. And besides that, if somehow every single biblical scroll had like been captured by the Romans and burned, you could still reconstruct the entire New Testament from quotations of the early church fathers. If then you allowed me to add in manuscripts discovered in other languages like Syriac, Ethiopic, Aramean, and especially Latin, that would bring the total up to over 24,700 ancient manuscripts. Guys, there is a ridiculously abundant wealth of manuscript evidence for the New Testament. Way more, infinitely more than any other book. Now, the next manuscript test is what you might call autograph chronology, okay? So let me see if I can explain this simply. So the original document written by the author himself is what's called the original autograph. But we have almost no autographs for any book of history. What we do have are handwritten copies. So the important question is, how old is the oldest copy that's ever been discovered? How much time has passed between when the author wrote it down and the oldest copy we found? Because again, it's likely that maybe there's been some mistakes in copying over time. Are you with me? Can you nod your head? Am I talking too fast a little bit? Okay, you're with me. Okay, so again, let's look at our scale. Plutarch's Lives of the Nobles, where we get Shakespeare's story, Caesar's story written by Shakespeare, was written about 110 AD. But the oldest copy ever discovered comes from the 10th century, which is a span of 840 years. The Roman author Pliny is doing a little bit better. His is only a span of about 750 years. Tacitus is 1,000 years. For every writing of the Greek philosopher Aristotle, the span is over 1,300 years from the original writing to the oldest discovered copy. Now again, friends, this is not a sampling to make the New Testament look good. This is the norm when it comes to historical documents. And to prove it, again, I'll compare the Bible with the silver medal manuscript contender. Again, the second book in history for manuscript evidence is the Iliad, written by Homer around 900 BC. The Iliad, if you don't know, it tells the story of the Trojan War and all that Greek history stuff. But the oldest fragment in existence is from 400 BC. Still a span of 500 years from when it was written to the oldest copy ever discovered. So how's the New Testament doing? Well, the Apostle John was there again. He was at the foot of the cross. He was an eyewitness of the death and the resurrection of Jesus. But John, he was the last to sit down and write his gospel. He waited until he was in exile near the end of his life. He didn't get around to writing it till about 90 AD. And yet the oldest New Testament fragment archaeologists have ever uncovered is this one right here. It's called P52, or Ryland's Fragment. And it is dated at about 125 AD, just 35 years after the original was written. This comes from John chapter 18. Are you curious what it is? It's actually a fragment of the story of Jesus being on trial before Pontius Pilate. when Pilate is asking the question, who are you really? Are you the king of the Jews? Whoa. I mean, this is utterly unheard of when it comes to ancient documents. At least 15 other New Testament papyri have been radiocarbon dated to less than 100 years from their original autographs. In fact, the evidence is so overwhelming that Sir Frederick Kenyon, former director of the British Museum, concluded, in no other case is the interval of time between the composition of the book and the date of the earliest manuscripts so short as that of the New Testament. It's unheard of in the academic world. But here's the deal, friends. When you're talking to someone about the Bible and you're, you know, we're saying, you know, I believe in the Bible, maybe even sing the song, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, they might push back and say, well, I don't believe the Bible because it's full of errors. And when they say that, what they probably mean is that as it was transmitted over the years, sometimes monks made copying mistakes. Again, 24,000 copies. Yes, there's going to be some copying mistakes in there somewhere. This is undeniably true. But listen, it is also not troubling or damaging to Christianity at all. About 95% of copying errors, and this is what I studied in college, okay? This is Greek 3 and Greek 4 to me, was studying these errors. They are trivial things like spelling and word displacement, skipping over a word and so on, inconsequential small things. And so, for instance, here's a real copy variation right here, Mark chapter 1, verse 2. One copy says, it is written in Isaiah the prophet, I will send my messenger, and so on. The second copy says this, it is written in the prophets, I will send my messenger, and so on. It was clear that that particular monk who was copying it, he skipped over the word Isaiah. Now, maybe this bothers you. Maybe this whole throws your whole faith in a loop. But for me, this doesn't bother me at all. I read this and I'm like, who cares? No big deal. It says the exact same thing. The point is exactly the same. I'm not losing sleep over this. Because again, as we just illustrated, there is such an abundance of manuscripts, infinitely more than any other ancient document, it is so easy for scholars to recognize the copying mistakes and realize, oh, okay, we see what's going on there. In fact, of the 20,000 lines of text in the New Testament, there are only 40 lines that there's some doubt or confusion. That means 99.8% of the Bible they are totally certain about. And you can read your Bible knowing we got the original text. And so, okay, you're like 99.8%. Well, that's pretty good, but that's not 100. So what's that last 0.2%? But friends, you've already read it. If you've got any English study Bible and you're reading along, there in a footnote, it says, in an earlier manuscript, it says this. That's the 0.2%. Those are the 40 lines that they have a little confusion about. It's not a conspiracy. It's not a cover-up. It's been there the whole time. You can read and decide for yourself. And again, we have so much good evidence and old evidence that, friends, you can trust your Bible so much better than you can trust any other document of history. In fact, if you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. There is not a single historical or theological belief that is changed by or dependent on a textual variant. Not a single historical or theological belief that is changed by or dependent on a textual variant. Because again, you know, some people hear that news that, you know, some of the monks made copying errors and then they just throw that out and they're like, oh no, they're you know, it's been changed or something like that. But I'm telling you, friends, the errors are so inconsequential and there's not like a secret version of the gospel out there somewhere where Jesus dies and stays in the tomb. It's not there. In all the copies, he rises again. In all the ancient manuscripts, he walks on water. In all the ancient manuscripts, he performs miracles and changes the water in the wine and raises the dead and drives out demons. All that stuff that you're struggling with, that you have a problem with, it's all in the original manuscripts. You got to deal with that. Whew. Okay. Some of you are thinking, man, I should have gone back for that second cup of coffee. Why didn't I do that? Some of you, you're trying to take notes and you gave up 5 minutes ago. That's okay. Well, all this stuff will be online. You can take notes later. But let's get to the point. What are all these numbers mean? What are all this evidence and statistics? What does it come to? What's the conclusion? Here it is. It means there is a mountain of evidence, historical evidence, that you can trust that what you read in the Bible is the same words as the original author. It's the authentic report. In fact, if you missed it, let me fill in the blanks for you. There is actually more historical evidence for the biography, the story of Jesus Christ, than there is historical evidence for the life of Julius Caesar. Well, at least he got a salad named after him, so he's doing pretty good. But again, no one's reading Shakespeare and saying, well, I don't think that's what really happened with Caesar. No, of course not. We trust it as historical evidence, so also we should with Jesus. Okay, well, maybe all this information, all this evidence is comforting to some of you, but maybe for some of you, you still protest because you point out, well, yeah, but there are four different Gospels, four different biographies of Jesus's life written by four different authors, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And I've been told, isn't it true that those four biographies are full of contradictions? And I'll tell you, I remember the first time is when I was in high school. I was reading along, and it must have been leading up to Easter or something like that, because I was reading the different versions of the story of the crucifixion and everything when I came across the first apparent contradiction. And I can't remember what version I was reading, but I remember reading in one of the Gospels, it was talking about the soldiers mocking Jesus, and it said they put a red robe on him and pretended to worship him and mocked him. And then in another version, it said they put a purple robe on him and were mocking him. And my little underdeveloped teenage brain, I was just like, oh no, what's the deal? Can I trust this? They don't even know what the color of the robe was. But friends, if you take a moment and employ a little logic, wouldn't it make sense that if there were two witnesses who saw the exact same event and the robe was like a dark crimson or something, that one person writing about it later would say that that robe was kind of reddish and the other person said it was kind of purple? But again, listen carefully, the variation in the eyewitness testimony actually confirms and corroborates the story instead of falsifying it. Again, homicide detective Jim Wallace will tell you, in every single case, and case after case, as a detective, this is what he sees. You're going to get slightly different stories from the eyewitnesses. That's normal, that's expected. Ask any police officer, ask any lawyer, that's what they're going to tell you. Everyone sees that same event from their own perspective. Actually, what is much more troubling is when the eyewitnesses all give an exact word-by-word account, because the investigator then is suspicious of collusion. Collusion would be that, they're trying to cover something up, so they all got together and they made sure that they got their story straight before they gave their testimony. Yes, four different men wrote four different Gospels, and they each got to choose to tell that same true story whichever way they wanted, and some included stories that others didn't. Some included minor incidental details that others don't. But friends, when you put them together, you don't see these huge irreconcilable contradictions. Instead, you get agreement and harmony on the important facts of Jesus' life. Okay. Well, maybe if you're struggling with this Bible stuff, you're still not budging. Maybe you're starting to budge a little bit, saying, okay, maybe there's some evidence I should look a little bit more into. There's some good evidence that we got an accurate New Testament. But maybe even if we know we've got the original writings of the original authors, maybe you're still struggling, buying into this whole Bible stuff, because let's face it, I mean, it's got stories about healing and miracles and blind men, being able to see, as we saw last week, a story about a guy walking on water, and maybe you can't buy into this Bible stuff because it just seems like a fairy tale to you. Two things to say. Number one, of course, we talked about how a few weeks ago, I encourage you to look back at that message. We talked about how miracles, by definition, are something that is outside of nature and cannot be proven nor disproven by science. That's one thing to think about. But secondly, if you study them, the Gospels are not written like a fairy tale. See, myths and fairy tales start with, once upon a time, Or many, many years ago in an enchanted forest, or my personal favorite, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. But look at how Luke, the historian, writes his story. He says, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod, tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the desert. Now, when was this supposed to have happened? Guys, Luke is making sure there's no confusion. I mean, he is giving us detailed, personal names and dates and locations. He is inviting you, go ahead and fact check me. He's claiming that this story about Jesus took place in a real time, in a real place. It wasn't on Mount Olympus somewhere. It took place in real history. C.S. Lewis was a famous atheist who later became a fully devoted Christian and would defend the Christian faith. But Lewis was a professor, he was an Oxford scholar, and he was a world-class literary critic. I mean, he's the expert on this kind of thing. But this is what Lewis says about reading the Gospels. He says, I've been reading poems, romances, vision literature, legends, and myths all my life. I know what they are like. And I know none of them are like this. Of this gospel text, there are only two possible views. Either this is reportage, meaning they're just reporting the facts, or else some unknown ancient writer suddenly anticipated the whole technique of modern novelistic realistic narrative. There was no historical fiction in the first century. People didn't write like that. Instead, what we can see in the New Testament, what we have is an accurate, detailed history of the life of Jesus of Nazareth, written, get this, in the same generation as the events and carefully preserved to us today. Guys, if you study the evidence, and I realize I'm just touching the tip of the iceberg this morning, if you go down and look up the evidence, the question before you is not, is it trustworthy? But as you encounter the reports of the risen Savior, the question you got to wrestle with is, what am I going to do with this? What does this mean for me? Because friends, again, if you're taking notes, Christianity, it actually begins with an event even before a book. Now, hang on, hear me out. When you read through the book of Acts, you know, it's the story about how the early church spread and the disciples, they're going to different towns and villages and they're preaching the word and telling the crowds about Jesus. They don't come with this big book and say, okay, everybody go home, read this book and come back. You can become a Christian. No, what do? They preach the gospel. They tell the story of who Jesus was, what he said, how he died, and more importantly, how he rose again from the grave. There is no other king, no other religious founder, no other prophet, no other leader, teacher, or philosopher who can make a claim like that. Guys, the resurrection changes everything. I mean, think about this. If this guy actually rose from the dead, I don't know about you, but I'm going to follow that guy. I'm going to follow the guy that rose from the dead. Because if two people are arguing about spiritual things or philosophy or, you know, what happens in the afterlife and they can't agree about it, I'm going to go with the guy who rose from the dead. I'm going to trust his opinion on it. I mean, that event, it verifies everything that Jesus said was true. And if Jesus said some things that are tough to swallow, that he is, you know, the Son of God the Father, that he's the Messiah, if Jesus talked about Abraham and Adam and Eve like they were real historical people, I mean, I know that's kind of tough, but I'm going to go with it because he's the only one I know who rose from the dead. It means his word is true. And realize again, the church was born, it got traction in the same generation just a few years after the people who knew Jesus and walked with him. I mean, think about this. If you want to create a legend about a resurrection, to try to prove that the people who are already in power are right, okay? If you're gonna make that up, you don't start telling that legend until about a couple hundred years after the event. After all the eyewitnesses and their kids and their grandkids are all dead and long gone, then you can start telling that story. But that's not what we get in the New Testament. Instead, the Apostle Paul writes this: "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom were still living, though some had fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me." Now, friends, the academic community agrees that this letter was written somewhere between 15 to 20 years after the resurrection. Meaning those who were there are still alive. And that's what Paul says. He says, you don't trust me? Go talk to them. They're still around. It's like, you know, the first century version of Snopes.com. Fact check me. Check it out. Investigate for yourself. And again, some people that, if you're holding on to, no, I don't believe that the Bible is true. I can't believe in the miracles and stuff. You know, maybe you're thinking, well, it was all a big hoax. You know, all this resurrection stuff. It was just a big lie that the disciples made up. And if that's your perspective, I got to ask, or I got to say, I kind of think it would be the worst conspiracy ever. Because you've got to ask the question, what is the motive? What's the motive? Again, homicide detectives, they say that almost all murders they happen for one of three reasons. Almost all of them fall into one of these three categories, either greed or lust or power. And so for any crime, any conspiracy, there's got to be a motive. There's got to be a benefit for you, okay? Either they're doing it for financial gain or for sex or for influence or something. But guys, for the disciples, spreading the word that Jesus is alive, there's none of that. Instead, they are imprisoned, mocked, ostracized from society. They are beaten, tortured, and eventually executed for telling people that Jesus rose from the dead. I mean, they're not getting rich or lots of women or powerful friends. They're getting the total opposite: poverty and danger and shame and death. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was, you know, telling this lie to make me look good about, hey, I saw Jesus rose from the dead, but as soon as they, like, get out the shackles and they even hint at the idea, we're going to throw you in jail for this, I'm going to say, just kidding. Made it up. But they don't. They refuse to change their story. And they gave their lives for what they saw, not for what they believed. That's a huge difference. Because there are many people who will die for things they sincerely believe in, but they can't verify. But the disciples knew the absolute truth. And yet they could not recant. They could not deny what they had witnessed and experienced with their own eyes. And they gave their lives to pass on the story. So much so that it even came down to us, that you and I can know the story of Jesus Christ to this day. And so, friends, I dare you to read it. And so maybe some of you, or maybe you're watching online and all this stuff, you know, you got your arms crossed, you're like, forget it. I still don't buy into it. I still am skeptical. Even if that's you, you're still skeptical. I still dare you to read it anyway. I mean, you ever come across an article in the newspaper and, I mean, do you want to make sure you believe it before you read the newspaper article? No. You read it and then you decide. So do the same thing with the New Testament. Read it. I dare you. Well, friends, I'm out of time. So here in a moment, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. So I'm going to go ahead and invite Pastor Stephen back up here. And he's going to play for us here in a moment. But before we transition into that moment, let's revisit our friend J. Warner Wallace. Remember, he's the cold case detective. And if you recall his story, he set out to use his criminal investigation skills and his experience to either confirm the New Testament was authentic or either to prove it was just one huge fraud. Well, let's watch this clip. This actually comes from an ABC News report about Wallace's life. Watch this.
Jim put his training as a detective to work and pored over the Gospels. He discovered something that in his line of work was critical to any investigation, eyewitness accounts.
If you have multiple eyewitnesses that see the same event, they never tell you the same story, but they do tell you a story that can be seen together like a puzzle. I was seeing these characteristics in the Gospels, and I thought, wow, you know, in some aspects, I think this stuff feels and looks a lot like eyewitness testimony. And so I was willing to take a step with it and start to examine it as an eyewitness account to see if it would hold up. So I think as I went through that process of digging, looking at language, looking at the template that I used to evaluate eyewitnesses, I became more comfortable and more confident that those were accurate, reliable eyewitness accounts.
When Jim's atheism couldn't stand in the light of the evidence, he was faced with one question.
Why do we need a savior?
To answer that question, Jim had to admit that his pride was keeping him from accepting the truth about Jesus.
It wasn't that there wasn't enough evidence. It was all about realizing I'm not God and realizing that, man, I'm a mess. And there's a lot about my life that I would like to change, a lot that I'm not proud of, a lot that I need forgiveness for.
Jim, the good guy, needed a savior too.
I, for a lot of years, worked hard to resist God's spirit. And at some point, I just said, okay, I'm done. I believe it. I'm in. I submitted everything to him. I submitted everything to Christ. I submitted every waking thought.
I felt like I was getting to witness a miracle just unfold right before me. It was just amazing.
Jim went on to become a celebrated cold case detective. He also defends his faith as a Christian apologist. Together, he and Susie have built their lives on the truth of God's word.
God knew me. He knew how committed I was to looking at evidence. And I think God reached me through that evidence. It may not be how everyone hears the gospel for the first time. But for folks like me, I needed to be reached this way. So I'm only a Christian today because it's true.
Friends, it's easy to just repeat something that you read on Facebook or Reddit or something. It's easy to just write it off and say, ah, I don't believe that. But I warn you. If you want to hold tight to that position that you know, the Bible's, it's all made up. If you want to hold on to that, don't look into the evidence. Don't read any of Wallace's books. Don't look him up on YouTube or it's going to mess with you. Because I think you'll come to the same conclusion I do, that the New Testament is accurate, that Jesus is who he says he is, and we can trust in him. Let's pray. Lord God, I just want to pray right now. Lord, for anyone in the room today or anyone watching online, maybe they're watching this online video months after this Sunday, but Lord, if they're wrestling with that question, can I trust the Bible? Is it real? Is it reliable? Lord God, I just pray one thing over them. I just pray that you would help them to be open-minded and that they wouldn't go into that question with presuppositions and start with the decision already in mind, but Lord, I just pray that they would walk into and that they would examine the evidence with a soft heart and an open mind. And Lord, if you are real and if it's true, I pray that they would find you. And for those of us who already have staked our whole lives on Jesus, for those people around us that are far from you, Lord, help us to be instruments of your word. Help us to be vessels carrying that gospel truth to them, that they too may find you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Well, friends, at this time, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And so we're going to have a couple moments of quiet reflection. If you need to get your heart in the right place, if you've had a crazy busy week, if you haven't taken the time to pray or spend time with the Lord in weeks, let's use these next few moments to connect with Him. And then we'll take the Lord's Supper together. So let's just have a few moments of reflection. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for the hope we have. And Lord, as we partake of this ancient sacrament, Lord, I pray that it wouldn't be just another religious routine or ritual or tradition. But Lord Jesus, I pray that we would encounter you in a spiritual way. May you be present. May this be a meaningful moment where we connect with you, we commune with you. We pray these things in your name. Amen. I'm going to invite the ushers to take their places. So friends, at this time, I'm going to be inviting you down to the tables. There's four different stations. And so to make this easy, if you would just, the two columns, the rows here, if you would move toward the center and down the center aisle, these two columns over here, move to the center and down the center aisle. And then after you have the elements, go back the outer aisles to your place. And after everyone's received the elements, I'll lead us, and we'll all take the Lord's Supper together. So friends, at this time, I invite you down to the table.
And be made. this mercy tree.
Amen. Friends, would you stand with me if you're able? And would you take with me the bread? On that night in which our Savior was betrayed, he took some bread from the table. And after he tore it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for you, take, eat, and be thankful." Would you take with me the cup? On that same night, our Savior took a cup, and after he blessed it, he gave it to his followers and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was poured out for your sin and for mine, take, drink, and be thankful." And now, friends, I'm going to dismiss you this morning. And as you're departing, the worship team is going to sing one more song for us as you're going out. So you can stay and sing, or you can mosey on out. But as you depart this morning, receive this blessing. May the Word of God be more than just text printed on a page. May it be written in your hearts and lives. And may everyone around you see the gospel in your life. Amen. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my doom till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Amen.
The old me knew Jesus when I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my glorious day.
We all need rescuing from Jesus, don't we?
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. My chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. You call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, and I ran out of that grave. you called my name. And I ran out of that grace, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Go in peace. Go in peace in the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.